City. The Dean of Xavier University College of Law, Attorney Raul Rocky Villanueva.
Good morning po.
Mayang buntag. Mayang buntag. And of course, from the Political Science Department of the University of Santo Tomas, a firm believer in federalism and parliamentary changes in our structure of government, Dr. Edmond Tayal. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Senator.
Yes. Okay. We're here today, this morning, to discuss about a proposed truth commission. The first question we have on our minds is, in the light of all the other bodies already investigating the Mamasapano incident, in the light of everything that has been brought out to the public so far, is there still a need for the Truth Commission? Second, if we do have a Truth Commission, for what will it be? Ano pong layunin ng Truth Commission? Saan po ang pupuntahan ito? Sinasabi nga nila sa Cebuano, unsay tumong. Where are we going with this Truth Commission? And on a larger picture, people have said as critique, saying that we don't need truth commissions anymore because we already have institutions of government, institutions of society that handle crises like the Mamasapano incident. On the other hand, there are people who say, no, we should institutionalize truth commissions so that when we have profound crises such as the Mamasapano, we can operationalize truth commissions immediately so that the ends of society are served, because the society, the institutions of government right now are not strong enough. They're saying that our democracy right now is a young democracy, and so much more so for our institutions that are still developing into maturity. Therefore, we need truth commissions. These are the answers that we would like to ask and hopefully find answers to these questions. And so I will be calling on the various resource persons. Again, thank you all for coming today. I will be calling on these resource persons, and please answer these questions and raise other issues which you feel should be raised. Maybe we can start from right to left. Maybe we can start with Father Bert Alejo.
Magandang umaga po, Senator, at saka sa mga naghahanap ng katotohanan at kapayapaan. Yun ang unang tanong, kailangan pa ba ng Truth Commission? Ang dami-dami ng labo-labo na nga po yung mga investigasyon. Ako, naninindigan na kailangan po talaga sa ngayon. Sapagkat lahat po ng nakita kong mga pagtatanong ay pag-uusig. Nang lumilito po ay, na mga sagot ay pagdidepensa sa sarili. Ang kailangan natin sigurong paghahanap ng totoo ay yung sa totoo lang. At bahagi yun ng totoo, hindi lang yung datos eh. Hindi lang ano yung nangyari. Bahagi ng totoo ay yung mga damdamin, kalooban, sa yung galit. Kasama ko yan sa totoo. Hindi lang yung ano yung nangyari, kundi ano yung nagawa ko at ano yung nagawa kong mali. Kasama po sa totoo, hindi lang yung kung sino may kasalanan, kundi yung mga damdamin na galit ako o pero kaya ko pa rin magpatawad o kaya gusto ko pa rin makinig sa sinasabi ng iba. Yun ang siguro ang sinasabi ko dito. What we need is truth commission, not just facts, finding facts. And by this, I would like to present po humbly state na by what we are after here is truth and not just the sequence of events, not just facts. But if we are looking for facts as truth, we must include feelings. Siguro, yun ang sinasabi ko dito. Kailangan natin ng truth commission, pero yung truth commission po na hindi lang basta fact-finding. At kung fact-finding man po, yung facts po ay kailangan pati ang mga feelings, mga damdamin. Kasama po dito sa hinahanap natin, yung mga pagtatanong, mga pagduda, pagbabalik tanaw. Yun pong, halimbawa, binagawa ako, totoo yun, may kasalanan ako, pero totoo rin na nagigilty ako sa ngayon. Totoo rin na yun, nagbabago yung isip ko na nakikita ko mali ako. Sana ho, yung paghahanap ng totoo ay kasama yung ganong klaseng mga pangyayari sa kalooban ng mga tao. At hindi ko nakikita na nabubuo ito sa mga kasalukuyang paghahanap ng katotohanan, mga investigasyon. Kaya ho, kagaling-galang na senador, suporta po ako sa paghahanap ng katotohanan sa pamamagitan ng Truth Commission. Pero gusto kong ipahatid na sana, una, kasama sa facts, yung mga totoo ay yung mga kwento ng kalooban ng tao. Kasama ang mga damdamin na guilty ako, kasama yung damdamin na kaya ko magpatawad, kasama yung damdamin na galit ako, kasama yung damdamin na gusto kong makinig sa iba, kasama yung damdamin na kung may napatay ako, napatayan din kami. Kung napatayan kami, pero may napatay din ako. Kasana ho, isama natin yung buong katotohanan ng trahedya na ito. Kaya ho, kung ganito ang ating approach, hindi lang sisihan, kundi aminan, pambansang pagdagok sa katotohanan, sana po, palawakin natin Truth Commission, gawin ho natin Truth, Justice, and Reconciliation Commission.
Truth, Justice, and Reconciliation Commission. Hindi lang sisihan, kundi, ano sabi niyo po?
Aminan. Angkinan. Para makapagbalik loob. Katunayan ho, pag tinignan lang ho natin anong nangyari, halimbawa, nagawa ko, masama. Yun lang ang interest mo sa akin. Tanungin mo naman ako, anong pakiramdam ko ngayon? Baka mamaya, nagsisisi na ako dun sa ginawa ko. Isama ho natin iyon sa paghahanap ng totoo. Dahil bahagi ng totoo ay yung sarili kong pagbabalik loob at ang kakayahan ko rin magpatawad.
So isa dun po yung, ano, yung definition ng ano yung justisya. Apo. At ano yung reconciliation. What is reconciliation then?
Yung reconciliation po, yung bang una, pag-amin sa mali ko, pag hindi rin pagtatago na mali ka, pero kasabay ho noon ay yung pagbabalik loob at pagkakasundo. Ano ba yung pagkakasundo? Yung bang gumagalaw ka sa kung saan ka galing eh. Handa dyan ka, susunduin mo ako. Andito ako, susunduin kita, magkita tayo sa gitna, magyakap tayo, magkamayan. Yun ho yung pagkakasundo. Tapos yung sinasabi ho dito ay pagbabalik loob din. Na may kakayanan tao na aminin eh, na may mali rin ako, katunayan may mali ka rin. Ang maganda ho sa sitwasyon na to, sa aking pananaw ho, sa limitado akong pananaw, parehong may mali eh. Pero kung sabihin ho natin eh, ako'y tama, ikaw lang ang may mali, eh, hindi ho tayo nag-aaminan eh. Wala tayong mararating ho niyan. Buti pa ho, limilitaw na pinilalabas mo yung mali ko, palagi ko naman, meron akong kayang aminin dyan eh. Inilabas ko yung mali mo, palagi ko naman eh, meron kang kayang aminin dyan eh. Mag-aminan ho tayo, magpatawaran at gumawa tayo ng landas para sa pagbabago, yung pagbabalik lobo. Ngayon, ano yung katarungan naman dyan? Kasama ho dyan yung talagang may mali, una-una aminin na niya. Total, lilitaw din naman eh. At yun ho talagang may parusa, lapatan ng parusa, pero at the same time po, kasabay ho noon, baka naman sa pag-amin niya, sa totoo niyang ginawa, eh ako naman eh matuto rin magpatawad. Lalong-lalo na kung aaminin ko rin, pati ako may mali rin, no? Sana ho, itong Truth Commission, hindi lang ito case build up against the other.
Not just parang a legal case build up against
case
to file a case.
Against the other, hanapan natin ng mali yung kabila, itago natin lahat ng mali natin. Pagka ganyan ho, kayo maabot. Paulit-ulit, nasubukan na ho natin yan. Nabatuhan, pero pareho tayong may pasa. Pareho tayong bugbog.
So emphasis po sa inyo yung justicia and then pag-aamin and then reconciliation.
Opo, pagkakasundo at pagbabalikan. Kasi kahit na tayo magsisihan, mag-away ho tayo ngayon, mapapagod din tayo sa away eh. Baka isang buwan, dalawang buwan, babalik din tayo sa pag-uusap eh. Pag-usapan na ho natin ngayon. Pag-usapan na po natin ngayon.
Thank you, Father Bert. Maybe let's jump to the other side. Dr. Edmond Tayao, sir, your thoughts on the matter.
Thank you, Senator. I actually share some thoughts with Father Alejo. Good morning, Father. Well, your question earlier whether we still need a commission, another body that will investigate. Well, definitely. You also mentioned about institutions. Actually, my question is, if we actually have functioning public institutions, and if we have functioning public institutions, if these public are these public institutions still acceptable to the people as public institutions? Actually, what we have is a crisis that is ongoing for as far as I can remember. Kasi if we do a if we come up with a truth commission, well, as the name says, we really need to find the incontrovertible truth. Sino ba talaga yung responsible? Lumalabas naman na eh. Kahit na gano'n natin pagtakpan, sabi nga ni Father, lalabas din yan. It's not a question really of wanting to pillory or whoever is responsible, but we want to find out who's responsible so that this doesn't happen again. So first we want to find out what exactly happened. But the reason why we want to find out what exactly happened is hopefully these facts can help us determine how do we institute reforms. Kasi the reason why I started with the question of public institutions is the problem with our institutions is always accountability. It's very easy to say I'm not responsible for this, and even with established institutional mechanisms, laging may lusot eh, no? Kumbaga, kahit na sabihin mong commander-in-chief, no? Eh parang ang lumalabas basta dinelegate mo tapos na yung issue. Now, more than determining who's the real decision maker here is to find out how to ensure that there will be not only coordination but at the very least some kind of institutional communication actually happens, no? So when we find out the truth, we learn from the truth and probably institute the reforms. And the third is rather broad, no? We have to look at the broader context of this issue. Alam niyo, Senator, this could have been an opportunity both on the part of the government and the MILF to show to the whole country that they can work together. And in other words, this could have been an opportunity, to not only coordinate, the MILF or whichever group that wants to establish some kind of administration or what in the country should be able to show to the whole country that they can be trusted. Kasi akala nila siguro issue lang ito sa Mindanao, and therefore it's they only have to convince the people of Mindanao, especially those who are going to vote for the BBL, no? Pero hindi. This is a national issue. So siguro si the Truth Commission might want to look at the context and again find out whether this issue is not only unique to the case of Mindanao. You know, napag-uusapan yung institutional reforms. We might want to now seriously look at options to shift from unitary to federal, which has always been an option for new democracies like ours. No, we have basically 80 ethno-linguistic groups in the country. Hindi ganun ka konti yon, no? And we might want to be able to maximize and in fact use to our advantage, no, this diversity instead of this diversity contributing to divisiveness in the country. So yun lang po kasi minsan akala natin yung issue sa Mindanao dun lang eh. The whole country can actually learn from it in the same manner that the MILF and the people from our Muslim brothers can also learn from the issues that happen in the whole country.
I'm just a bit intrigued about that statement you have about that this incident can also show us that it might be time to shift from unitary to federalism. Could you expand on that more?
Yes, Senator. Kasi po, nung, if we look at how the public hearings have been generating, you know, what happened exactly in the operation. So, yung area na yon, sabi nila, lahat daw dyan, puro MILF, magkakamag-anak, no? So, in other words, whether it's a military operation or what is it, the security forces of the MILF involved, no? Malaking factor yung ano eh, yung personal and family relations doon sa area. Of course, this not to mention of course the religious and the cultural considerations. That's why I said earlier this could have been a good model for the government and the MILF to show that they can work together, no? Pero yun na nga, hindi na nga nangyari. So I mentioned the federalism para maging open din yung, kasi dito sa Manila, pagka nadinig yung ganyan, girahin na natin, no? All out war. We don't understand exactly what will be the impact of the all out war. We're not there, eh, no? But if we consider some way by which, you know, some kind of autonomy or ability for self-determination, no? Not that kind of self-determination that we will allow them sovereignty all over the region, no? Probably can help us understand also the need for them or the need for everyone for assistance.
And yes, that applies not just down south, but any part of the country.
Any part of the country, Senator, even in the Cordilleras. My office has been also working with them. No, of course, the case of the north is significantly different from the case of the south. No, but on the other hand, the ethnic cultural factor is also there. But also, we need to understand how public administration impacts on the unique conditions at the local level. Eh? Lalo na ho, I'm sorry, but well, ever since I'm not a big fan of this administration, but this administration has been always centralized. Eh. But if the administration only could have tried to work closely with the local governments, siguro baka mas naging maganda pa yung, I don't know, but this is just how we see it from the kind of work that we do, no? Kasi mahirap yung nasa national, we tend to second guess what's best at the local level without us even knowing what exactly is happening at the local level. So the federal structure that I mentioned earlier has always been a ready strategy for new democracies, precisely to allow you know, a very productive coexistence, no, among different peoples, no? So I don't know, but this is really the right time for us to consider introducing systemic reforms.
Thank you very much for that very interesting point of view. Let's move to the to Davao City. From Davao City, the Executive Director of Al-Kalam Institute for Islamic Identities and Dialogue in Southeast Asia. I understand you are Dasi Datu Mussolini since what, Lidasan? Okay, I'll call you Moose for short. Is that all right?
Yeah, it's okay.
You are a NGO embedded with the Ateneo de Davao, and
no,
I understand.
The Al-Kalam Institute is a institute within the Ateneo. We are under the University Research Council. My background is legal anthropology and Islam anthropology of Islam. Sorry, if I may, in answering po yung question ninyo, I prepared a statement, if I may.
Please proceed.
Okay. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. In a statement entitled, A Call for Peace Through a Judicious and Reasoned Response to the Mamasapano Clash, several signatories, scholars of Mindanao and Sulu, noted the importance of historical, political, and cultural nuance in understanding the many conflicts between the Philippine state and local groups like the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. And there is a need to fully apprehend the long-standing conflict between Moros and government forces in a complex and convoluted, and that is difficult to arrive at simple or black and white explanations for events. Achieving a lasting peace has been a major challenge. Yet the Bangsamoro negotiations, begun in earnest, the MILF and national government have signed agreements and developed protocols with the armed forces of the Philippines to maintain the truce. The statement also supports the creation of a truce commission. And I quote, "We say yes to an independent and impartial investigation in the Mamasapano clash and the creation of a truth commission to uncover the facts of the encounter and enable the country to move forward towards building peace and restoring trust." Unquote. The complexities of the Bangsamoro peace process require a more inclusive search for justice and truth. Cardinal Orlando B. Quevedo, OMI, Archbishop of Cotabato, said in an interview that justice should not be equated with revenge and should not be selective but inclusive for all those who were killed in Mamasapano, Maguindanao. It is in this premise that I believe the move of the Senate Bill, Senate in passing Senate Bill number 2603, the Mamasapano Truth Commission, be based. Not for the following, and for the following goals to be ultimately reached following this incident: reconciliation, non-repetition, rule of law, and non-impunity. The current text of the SB number 2603, Truth Commission, being envisioned by the Senate, fails to consider that there are at least 67 persons killed in the incident, 44 from the SAF, or the Special Action Force of the Philippine National Police, 18 from the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, and at least 5 civilians. Thus, if the creation of this Truth Commission essentially seeks to create a just present and future based on the understanding of the past and its continuity with the present, contestations and convergence in narratives, all from the parties, must be taken into account to see from which point one can render inclusive justice. Although we strongly support the move of Senator T.J. Gingona, Senator Bam Aquino, and Senator Coco Pimentel in passing SB numbers 2603, we propose that we align the creation of a truth commission in the provision of transitional justice within the Bangsamoro Basic Law, or House Bill, or Senate Bill 2408. Under Section 4, Article 9 of the Basic Rights of the BBL defines transitional justice as a mechanism to address the legitimate grievance of the Bangsamoro people, such as historical injustices, human rights violations, marginalization through unjust dispossession of their territorial and proprietary rights, and customary land tenure. This is our proposal, Mr. Senator. The Mamasapano tragedy is not the first incident of missed encounters between the Moro Islamic Liberation Front and the government troops. It is not also the first incident of massacres that killed innocent civilians. The goal of the BBL is to provide a mechanism that can address historical injustices and pave the road to reconciliation. Pursuing a truth commission that only dwells in the recent event of the Mamasapano may instead deepen the wounds that it seeks to heal. Therefore, we recommend a truth commission that provides a wider discourse on the social visions of truth, justice, and reparation. The truth commission that we propose should lead us in an inclusive process involving affected communities, conflict actors, and the wider post-conflict society. Moreover, the truth commission can lead the way to learning from previous experiences in dealing with the past, of lessons learned from other contexts, and of local needs and expectations. Only then can the emotional energies that are palpable on issues of justice and reconciliation be channeled in constructive engagements. Lastly, we believe that the current Bangsamoro peace process provides channels for such engagements by stipulating a transitional justice program that addresses the legitimate grievances of the Bangsamoro people, correct historical injustice, and address human rights violations. The Annex on Normalization also provides the creation of Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Commission, mandated to study and recommend appropriate mechanisms for transitional justice and reconciliation. However, the Annex on Normalization is part of the executive power. We need to have a strong body like the Truth Commission that will handle the issues like the Mamasapano tragedy and all other massacres in Mindanao. Thank you and wassalamu alaikum.
Thank you. Let us move to, from Davao City, let's move to Cagayan de Oro City. Dean Rocky Villanueva of the Xavier University College of Law. Sir, your
thank
thoughts,
you.
Please.
Thank you very much, Senator TG, and thank you very much for this invitation. Firstly, I agree with the observation of Father Bert, Mr. Dadasen, and Dr. Tayao with regards to federalism. And since the first question is whether we should come up with a truth commission, I totally agree that we should come up with a truth commission. Presently, there are several agencies of government that are conducting their own fact findings. And I believe there should be a common denominator to all of these. This should be centralized through the Truth Commission, and the Truth Commission can deputize all these other agencies who will collect the facts. And the Truth Commission can winnow all the information that will be gathered. And since this crisis that happened not only affects Mindanao, it has a national importance, I also would suggest that we expand the membership of the commission. Presently, as written, the commission only has 3 members. I would suggest that we make it a 5-member commission. The chairman should be a retired justice of the Supreme Court. The members should include 1 from the Muslim community, not necessarily from the MILF, 1 from the private sector, 1 a retired officer of the Philippine National Police who has unquestionable integrity, probity, good moral character, and patriotism. I think he should be one who is retired so that he will have no connection with the current leadership, and a member of the Department of Justice. So this will be a 5-team committee of the Truth Commission to be headed by a retired justice of the Supreme Court. Thank you, Mr. Senator.
Thank you, Dean Villanueva. So you're in support of it, and in spite of all these bodies that are presently investigating it, the incident, you still see the need that there should be a truth commission.
Yes, Mr. Senator, because the truth commission can actually centralize all this information. As of now, the general public are in quandary as to which investigating body to believe. There is the Congress, there's the Senate, there's the Board of Inquiry, there's the Human Rights, there is the DOJ, there is the MILF, and I understand there's the leftist group that's also conducted its own investigation. So if we can centralize this via the Truth Commission, the perception of the public will be addressed. Because right now, I think the public is in a quandary as to which investigating panel to follow. So if we centralize this, this will help the perception that there is just one common investigating body who will conduct this inquiry.
And I think also that would help because if you have these specialized bodies, they would look at it with their own lens. For example, Human Rights would Commission on Human Rights would see it from the lens of human rights violations.
Exactly, Mr. Senator.
The Board of Inquiry of the Philippine National Police from the police operations point of view. So, yes, that might be a good point to consider. Thank you, Dean.
Thank you, Rock. Senator.
Before I proceed, yung mga may opening statement po, paki-submit na lang yung mga written sa Secretariat. Before we proceed, can we have a 1-minute suspension? Okay, hearing resumed. Okay, from Cagayan de Oro, let's move to the Quezon City, the University of the Philippines College of Law. Professor Merlin Magalona. Sir, good morning. Your thoughts, please.
Good morning, Honorable Chair. With your permission.
Please proceed.
With respect to your opening statement of issues, Mr. Chair, I suggest that this may be solved by two factors. First, we are confronted with the Senate bill providing for the creation of a Truth Commission, and its purpose, its content, and its mission may respond to the issues that you have presented in relation to the issues that have been presented by the resource persons. Secondly, many of the issues may be internalized into the commission itself and may be dealt with by the chairman and the members of the commission themselves. In other words, in the first place, therefore, we should depend on the substantive content of the bill creating the commission. And of course, we can see the creativity and imaginative temper of the chair and the members of the commission. Let me now proceed to a longer statement, Mr. Chairman. By the time that we see the light of day for the enactment of the law creating a truth commission, truth and justice out of the Mamasapano tragedy may have become more problematical. By that time, the public mind shall have been saturated with investigative reports, official and semi-official findings, interpretative opinions, and the still unfolding mass media information. Presented to the people in fragments, these varieties would appear as a cluster of half-truth, embedded in the official mission of the agencies making the reports, with no finality and no compelling authority. All these conditions on the whole make the formation of a truth commission a predicament. But we should resolve the dilemma by our estimate as to how the Mamasapano tragedy, how the death of the 44 patriots – has imprinted itself into the national conscience. We have to raise the issue as to how does it color our past as a people. For the future, will Mamasapano give us new moral ingredients by which we shall distill its blood and its tears into the historic mission of diversity and unity, of human rights and reconciliation? I venture to suggest, Mr. Chairman, that these are matters of concern for the Truth Commission, its moral and social rationale, in fact. Toward this end, the following issues and problems deserve resolution, and many of these may be resolved by the text of the Senate bill before us, and of course, the dynamic imagination of the composition of the Truth Commission. Issue number one, Senate Bill number 2603, creating the Mamasapano Truth Commission, appears to define its principal function and achieve its purpose in Section 1 when it provides that A, it is a fact-finding commission, and B, it is to determine all the facts and circumstances of the death of 44 and the wounding of 12 members of the Elite Special Action Force unit of the Philippine National Police during the encounter with other armed elements, which allegedly included members of the Bangsamoro Islamic Freedom Fighters and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. This immediately raises the issue as to the pertinence of the relevance of the casualties on the other side of the encounter. Will the fact-finding be deliberately one-sided? In either way, whether the truth-seeking be one-sided or comprehensive, it is necessary for the Commission to have its physical presence in verification or confirmation of events or facts in the site where the encounter took place through time. Will this fact-finding be necessarily conducted in the vicinity within the territory controlled by the BIFF or the MILF? If so, what security measures are to be undertaken for the effective presence of the Commission? The security problem may become more acute if personal interview or contact with members of the MILF would prove to be imperative in the site of the encounter situated in MILF-controlled territory. Another issue. In Section 3 of the bill, the more concrete function of the Commission pertains to what appears as the prosecutory aspect of its work. Thus, it will, number one, collect, receive, review, and evaluate evidence. Number two, receive testimony of witnesses and examine them. And number three, utilize state witnesses to ensure that the ends of justice be fully served. Does this function imply that the Commission will engage in criminal investigation that will lead to the prosecution of crimes? Since the main function of the Commission pertains to the Mamasapano encounter involving the death of the 44 patriots, is not the Commission set in the mission of seeking justice in the context of commission of crimes? This appeared to be meaning the meaning of Section 7 of Senate Bill number 2603 when it defines, let me quote it, accountability of the Commission as entity created to serve justice, as its responsibility to the sovereign people by conducting investigation and issuing reports in an objective, thorough, and efficient manner, unquote. And yet the Senate bill is not clear of achieving this justice, as its primary function and purpose is short of being a tribunal, which it is not, does not appear to be so. Should the Commission, another issue, should the Commission be able to devote itself to criminal justice, it is strongly suggested that this be primarily on violation of human rights and international humanitarian law. Just the same, imposition of sanction remains a critical issue to be resolved in the proposed legislation creating the Commission. On one hand, it may be recognized as a principle that a system of sanction or punishment must be separated from truth-seeking in instituting a truth commission. On the other hand, truth commission without justice through sanction fails to meet the legitimate expectation of the victims and their families. In that case, truth-seeking is without accountability, violation of human rights characterized by absence of responsibility. We need to be reminded that the death of the four patriots necessarily entails a violation of human rights of the women and children in their families. Another issue. It would be timely to be reminded of what has become standards in the administration of justice associated with international justice in human rights violation as follows. Number one, these are the elements of what has been considered as an international standard in the administration of justice. And many of these have been promulgated by international human rights tribunals. Number one, reasonable means for the prevention of violation of human rights, the element of prevention. Number two, established measures for investigation of human rights violations, the investigative element. Number three, imposition of sanctions for human rights violation, the question or issue of sanction or punishment. And number four, appropriate reparation for the victims of human rights violations, which may include restitution, rehabilitation, or compensation. This will include the minimum sanction, namely the acceptance or the making of apology. This about the minimum standard that the party responsible would be expected to make an apology at the least. The encounter at Mamasapano is not to be treated merely as a failure in military tactic or planning. It will go down in the nation's political history as a massive violation of the Constitution, whose main thrust is expressed in its policy that I quote, "The state values the dignity of every human person and guarantees full respect for human rights." The last issue, Honorable Chairman, is with respect to the composition of the Truth Commission as proposed in the Senate bill. Considering the credibility factor, I suppose we might imply what the credibility factor is, considering the suggestion in the Senate bill. It is further suggested that the membership of the Truth Commission be composed of a chairman to be appointed on the recommendation of the Board of Governors of the Integrated Bar, owing to the fact that membership in the Philippine Bar is required by the bill. One commissioner on the recommendation of the Commission on Human Rights, and the third member upon the recommendation of the Senate Committee on Justice and Human Rights. Thank you for this opportunity, Honorable Chairman.
Thank you so much, Professor Magalona. Let's move to the convener of the Philippine Center for Islam and Democracy, a former Commission on Human Rights Commissioner, Attorney Nasser Mahoram Salik. Sir, your thoughts, sir.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just like Dato Mos here, I wish to be formal in my rendition. This is a very critical problem, and I have poured on thoughts on this. And so I refer myself, Your Honor, to my notes. And I read, there are many investigative bodies. About seven of them, I was told, inquiring into the Mamasapano incident with the aim in view of establishing its factual situation, its legal significance and implication. People may hold differing opinions on their trustworthiness. Whatever, what runs up my interest is not what people perceive them to be, but their kind of investigation, which will ultimately reveal itself at the end of the day. Thus, it is not fair, Your Honor, in fact, too early to ascribe negatives on their individual investigations. Spearheaders of these investigative bodies profess their commitment to peace and find the people on whom the acts of responsibility may fall. They can get as thorough as can be, but they should not see the forest for the trees. As of a vehicle, peace is so important to get held up to its hubs in the quagmire of details. Your Honor, I await the investigation report of the PNP Board of Inquiry and of the MILF, a constabulary general who served as our president, offered the reason for my stand. He said, and I quote, that a wounded soldier appreciates the meaning of peace more poignantly than the political demagogues who declare war in the name of peace and send the sons and daughters of their neighbors to the battlefront to fight and die. We must also await with delight and anticipation the reports of the instrumentalities of government, like the CHR, the DOJ, and volunteer or people's organizations who have also conducted their own individual investigations. That is being law-abiding. I take caveat, though, that their reports may clutter up the narrative on the Mamasapano incident and muddle up issues. But I have my administrative resolution to the problem. I propose that an ad hoc Mamasapano clarification body be created to collate and synthesize all these reports and make a one coherent report with recommendations and submit the same to Congress and the President. It must not hold an investigation hearing where ordinarily witnesses are called to testify and present documents, because this process will take a goodly odd time, even on a double time effort by the body. And with the peace with the Bangsamoro hanging on the balance and hints on the Mamasapano issue, time is of the essence. Let us not spoke the wheel of peace from turning too long. This action may not be in keeping with our religious soul as a people. I finished my secondary education in a Catholic school, from a Catholic school, and I learned that Jesus Christ is called by another name, the Prince of Peace. In Islam, one of the names of God is peace. The place of felicity in Islam is called the Abode of Peace. In both religions, our salutation is an expression of peace. To put a closure on the Mamasapano incident and get us to move on forward for peace, a truth commission is not the best instrumentality. It is because of the nature of the truth commission. I have this myself, a research which was just handed to me, and I wish to read it. In general, a truth commission is a temporary body established by an official authority to investigate a pattern of gross human rights violations committed over a period of time in the past. In the course of their investigations, truth commissions often focus on gathering data pertaining to victims in order to satisfy the right of family members who know what happened to know what happened to their loved ones. Truth commissions may conduct public or closed-door hearings in the fulfillment of their mandates, and in some cases may be required to make recommendations concerning amnesties or pardons. In this regard, they shall be cognizant of the fact that various sources of international law prohibit blanket amnesties for war crimes, crimes against humanity, genocide, or gross violation of human rights, including gender-specific violation. The findings of the truth commissions are usually made public upon the completion of their mandates, and in some cases periodically during the mandates, and provide not only an analysis of past cause, including root causes, but also include policy recommendations to ensure non-repetition in the future and to promote reconciliation among affected communities. The official acknowledgement of the commission report by its mandating body is an important factor in this regard. Indeed, by the nature of their office, truth commissions may realize the work within a few years. Let me remember to you the case of the Truth for Reconciliation Commission established in Thailand to investigate the shooting of research protesters against government between March and May of 2010, where at least 98 people died and more than 2,000 injured. The commission only presented its final report on September 17, 2012, a period of more than 2 years. To emphasize my proposal, the ad hoc Mamasapano clarification body does not go into full dress hearing like any adversarial proceeding or deliberative or finding body. It can, Your Honor, finish its work in 6 weeks. It is an independent body of 3 members or 5 members to invest it with independence and insulate it from political interference. I suggest that Archbishop Orlando Quibido be made as its chairman with authority to appoint its members and secretariat. I know he's not only a man of the cloth, his integrity is beyond question. He is also a connoisseur of peace and moral developments. The last time I checked, I had his peace of mind for an introduction in my article on the framework agreement in the IBP journal. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Attorney Nasser. If we will go into a discussion now, if there is anyone who wishes to say something, just raise your hand so we can recognize you. Attorney Nasser, I take note of your objection to a truth commission, and I'm also glad that you have an alternative. At the same time, you call it an ad hoc clarificatory body. Again, paano po ito? How will it be different from the commission? It will not receive testimonies anymore. What exactly will it do? It will reconcile conflicting, I suppose, if there are conflicting reports of the other committee, other bodies that have findings, they will reconcile it. But what if they are irreconcilable?
That is correct, Your Honor. The SADC committee should read in details all these reports and discuss among themselves. And perhaps they can also get, some experts to support them.
Excuse me.
Like the secretariat.
Yes, excuse me, Attorney Nasser. Forgive me for interrupting you, but I'd like to acknowledge my co-author in the Truth Commission and fellow senator from Mindanao, Senator Coco Pimentel. Mr. Senator, good morning. So please continue.
You're correct, Senator. In case of irreconcilable reports, they might employ expert witnesses, or they may conduct, closed door hearings, excluding the public, because that is the intention there, and shed light on these matters, or they can call on the investigative bodies which made the report, and perhaps make approving questions on these people.
Okay, thank you. Dato Mus, I'm intrigued by your statement about transitional justice and your concept of not just the present but historical injustice. And like you said, it's not just the first time it happened. We all know, mga taga Mindanao, we all know it's not the first time. Hopefully it's the last time. And you have a proposal on the matter, but that is different from the Truth Commission, because that would also run counter to, well, that would be in support of, that would run counter to the assertion of Attorney Nasser about taking too much time. So if we also delve into the historical injustices, it will take a lot of time. Your thoughts on the matter?
Yes, Your Honor. It's true that our proposal may take time, but first, the present text of Senate Bill 2603 only made mention about the 44 members of SAF and SAF PNP. However, there are 18 MILF who also died on that day, and at least 5 civilians. So, So these MILF victims or those who died on that day has an emotional and historical baggage. So meaning to say, it will also be unjust for us to do a truth commission based on the Mamasapano incident alone, without taking into consideration that all these things are in the context of the peace process. So we support the creation of a truth commission specifically on the Mamasapano, but there has to be a bigger truth commission specifically under the BBL, under the basic Bangsamoro basic law, in which it also made mention about the provision on transitional justice. But the existing text in the transitional justice did not made mention about the truth commission. It only made mention about the Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Commission, which is under the normalization process, which is under the executive. And that alone is, for us, we believe that it's very much lacking. There has to be a more broader scope of understanding the historical injustice and the current situation in Mindanao. That's the reason why we have this Bangsamoro peace process.
So this is an offshoot already, because but very interesting, very, very interesting. Your proposal is to have a historical truth commission embedded in the BBL as an institution that will go back and see the historical injustices since time.
Not necessarily since time immemorial, Mr. Chair, but we can look into the current, because even Chairman Iqbal, during the Senate hearing, I think he made mention of several massacres, and that I think is just 4 decades ago. So we can start with that, because even the uprising of the Moro National Liberation Front happened sometime in early 1970s. So we cannot go beyond other massacres like the Budaho massacre, the Budbagsak, the Battle of Bayam, all other massacres which included foreign nationals like the United States before.
Yes, I do remember the MNLF started, I think, I might be mistaken, when Jolo was burned, right? The advent of the Declaration of Martial Law.
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. Father Bert, yung pong concept nyo na justice, maganda yung sinabi nyo po yung hindi lang case build up in the sense of a lawyer, so that a case build up so that we can prosecute, which is a very Western, very traditional, very Western way of looking at it. You're saying that dapat ang patutunguhan nito yung reconciliation na, no? Pero isn't it true that you cannot have reconciliation without justice? And in that sense, how would you define justice if it would not be in the Western concept?
Maraming salamat po sa pag-ungkat uli noon. Hindi po natin inaalis ang justice, ang katarungan. Pero magkakasunod o yan eh. Paghanap sa totoo, paglalapat ng katarungan, at paglampas pa sa katarungan. Ano yung lampas doon? Yung pagbabalik loob. Sana po, itong Truth Commission ay makita natin bilang paraan natin ng paghihilom ng sugat, hindi paglilika ng bagong sugat. So, we hope that the Truth Commission should be rendered in the service of healing rather than producing new conflict. Because this is an attempt to heal wounds. And it is at this point that I'd like to pursue what I've been speaking about, that this is not just truth in the sense truth commission in the sense of fact finding, but understanding the facts in relation to relationships, and therefore we cannot measure the impact of this tragedy simply by counting dead bodies. As a matter of fact, we include the wounded. But wounds should include the social wounds, the psychological wounds. And that's why I'm pushing for a different kind of truth commission, which does not necessarily have to take longer. It's just an additional sensitivity. Now, that's why I'd like to propose that in the operation, in the conduct of the truth commission, we don't just put lawyers, which are important. But true to my understanding, my proposal, let's put in people there who are sensitive to feelings, collective sentiments, communal hurts, at the same time, communal and culture-based desire for peace. Now, when I say this, I mean, maybe we can put in social psychologists in the team. That's why I agree with expanding it, but not just putting more of the same. But let's put in the contribution of those who have sensitivity to culture, cultural hurts, cultural desire for peace, cultural ways of mending the damaged social fabric. And in further, let us not just heal the wounds among the victims. Let us address the sentiments that are created when we publicize the discussions. According to the bill, the conduct of the investigation will be made public, partial, periodic, and final, but we need to manage the sentiments that will emerge from this process of piecemeal installment shared information and based on the investigation. That's why, in addition to the sensitivity to the wounds that have to be healed among the victims, we need also to manage the damage that is stirred among the general population now that this thing has nationalized the issue. And that's why I call for the contribution of those who are engaged in peace communication. At the heart of conflict is miscommunication. Therefore, to heal conflict, we need to have a good strategy for peace communication. Right now, we expand the hurts, we expand the wounds by all kinds of sharp words and pointed statements. Maybe they're correct, but they inflict more wounds. And it has happened. It is now terrible. We need to include in this whole conduct of truth and justice and reconciliation commission a whole strategy for mending the damaged social fabric through peace communication. So on the whole, I want to go back to a premise that facts would include feelings. And if that is acceptable, then that should be reflected in the composition of the truth commission. And if that is allowed, then I would imagine a more creative approach to conducting a truth commission that leads not just to litigation, but to reconciliation. Yun po, Your Honor. Salamat po.
Thank you, Father Alejo, for your contribution, your words of wisdom, and I really appreciate what you said, because if we limit ourselves to the facts, then actually we might already have been overtaken by events, no? So, but to be very, very sure that all of the subject matters that you have mentioned or the topics that you mentioned are included in the report of the commission, maybe Section 6, we can amend it and specify the contents, the minimum contents. Pwede, siyempre pwedeng lampasan yung content, but the minimum contents of the report. Para, you know, so it's really spelled out, no? Walang alam. So even in the appointment of the members of the commission, hindi lahat lawyers. Kasi there's a content about moving forward, reconciliation, may peace, mayroon ngayon ko lang na rin peace communication. So tama po yun, no? I really appreciate what you said, that at the heart of any conflict is miscommunication. And at the heart of this tragedy is also miscommunication, actually. Not between or among adversaries, but miscommunication between allies is at the heart of this tragedy also. So what is the, Mr. Chairman, what has been the consensus that the Truth Commission is still relevant given the given all of the investigations which have actually terminated their proceedings?
Well, yes, there have been several very intriguing and interesting proposals. One is of Attorney Mahroman Salik about a, what do you call it, ad hoc reconciliation body. Is that the term you use, sir?
The name is ad hoc Mamasapano clarification body.
To reconcile the conflicting provisions of the various reports of the other bodies.
Pwede na yata dito yun. Because when we were discussing this, Mr. Chairman, ganun na yun, that part of the duties of the commission is to gather all of the reports. And since a Section 6, it can also publish or issue interim reports, pwede na siya mag reconciliation report.
But the problem, Your Honor, is the investigative process. A truth commission is a deliberative body, and you have to subpoena witnesses, place them on a witness stand, and make them render their testimonies and produce documents. And that will take a lot of time, just like the experience of Thailand, which took the Truth Reconciliation Commission more than 2 years to finish its work. That's the problem.
Two years is too long. Kaya nga, that's why I think we have sufficient flexibility. Section 3B, subpoena, andito the power. So we really envisioned may hearing. Ang tanong na lang ako, executive session sometimes, public sessions. And then, Section 6, flexibility is to issue the interim reports or partial reports. Tapos mayroon din final reports sa dulo.
But again, we could also adopt the testimonies already given in the previous bodies.
Yes, but pero siyempre, if the commissioners or the members of the commission want them to personally assess the demeanor of the person testifying, then pwede nilang ipapunta. Ano na po yun? I mean, di ba parang delegated na sa kanila, judgment call na nila yun?
Perhaps on a selective basis that can be provided. But even then, it will take really a lot of time. Because there will be people who would like also to contribute their own share in the investigation.
In the bill, and walang time limit, no?
Wala po.
So, dapat lagyan?
O, pag nilagyan niya ng 2 or 3 months po, in consideration of the BBL, that's, not constructive enough in the interest of peace. Dito po sa ad hoc Mamasapano clarification body, it will take only 6 weeks to do the job. And then there is a final report. Because there is no actually formal hearing or adversarial hearing or deliberative hearing. They will only collate and synthesize and into a coherent report, one report with recommendations. And if there is a need to clarify matters, perhaps they can call on witnesses. The problem, Your Honor, is technical, because Truth Commission is not ordinarily used for that kind of work. Its scope is expansive, Your Honor. It will include past events also, not just one event. In the investigation of one event or series of related events, we use the term, or we create a National Commission on Inquiry. But the process is the same as the Truth Commission. That is the problem in the creation of a National Commission on Inquiry.
Okay. We see Father Bert Alejo wants to say something. Father Bert Alejo.
Maraming salamat po. Gusto kong ipika po yung sinasabi ni Attorney Marob Salik. Siguro ang concern natin dito, yung bang huwag hintayin yung resulta nito bago simulan yung deliberation sa Bangsamoro. Baka naman ho po pwede na ituloy yung trabaho ng Truth Commission at ituloy na rin yung deliberation sa Bangsamoro. Huwag ho nating itali ang pagpapatuloy ng pag-discuss, pagtalakay sa Bangsamoro doon sa resulta ng Truth Commission. Pwede rin naman ho na yung trabaho ng Truth Commission, ang unahin ay yung synthesis ng mga naririto ng mga dokumento. So in that sense, the first stage of the work of the Truth Commission could respond to the work of the ad hoc committee proposed by Maruham Salik, but knowing that the available details of the investigation, existing investigation, would not match the required data, expanded data, for the bigger, the wider aim of the Truth Commission, let the Truth Commission proceed and complete its more sensitive task, and let not BBL deliberation depend on the final result of the Truth Commission.
Professor Tayao.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I like the idea of the Truth Commission on the premise that precisely there are so many investigating bodies, and as I've mentioned in my opening statement earlier, there's a crisis of public institutions in the sense that the I don't know how the public will still accept the results of these investigations. And precisely, there's a need to reconcile conflicting results of the investigation. I agree with Datu Moses' suggestion earlier of transitional justice. This is definitely needed. But what I think really is perhaps we can look at the BBL at the later date. To me, the BBL should not be a compromise as a result of the Mamasapano incident. We don't want to reenact ARM precisely because this has already been packaged precisely, not only by the administration but so many other observers, as a quote-unquote a failed experiment. In other words, we don't want another, well, of course, you already have the BIFF. We're not sure whether the BIFF will go the same way as the MILF when it separated from the MNLF. But precisely the reason why we'd like to have a Truth Commission is precisely we'd like to have a real opportunity for us to settle once and for all some lingering questions, or as mentioned, some injustices which may have already been committed before. The problem really is there have been so many problems in Philippine history that hindi pa natin, we have yet to find closure. No, of course, kaya nga nung binabasa ko yung bill, at the onset I'd like to suggest na magkaroon ng timetable, pero siguro matagal yung dalawang taon, no? But the timetable should be in a sense that it should be a requisite to the passage of a Bangsamoro Basic Law. In other words, to me, I don't agree that kahit na anong klaseng Bangsamoro Basic Law na lang ipasa na natin. Parang sayang eh. No? The opportunity is already there. But precisely because of this incident, parang nagtanong ulit yung mga tao, can we trust the MILF, or can we consider having an autonomous region in Mindanao? So perhaps the result of the investigation of the Truth Commission can finally settle things, and that we can reconsider again, no? This autonomous region na hindi yung natatakot tayo na hihiwalay sa Pilipinas, o natatakot tayo na magkakaroon sila ng mas maraming armas, na mga ganong mga tanong, no? So to me, the Truth Commission is really needed because other than the Senate, wala doon sa mga individual investigating agencies yung can fill up this lack of public trust, so to speak. Ayun lang, Mr. Chair.
Your Honor.
Professor Merlin.
Your Honors, many of the issues that are being raised here really belongs to the deliberation of the Truth Committee itself. And therefore, the main question is whether we should create it in the first place or not. We are interested in what is realizable. We are interested in what is practicable. We are interested in the implementation of what is measurable and implementable. And many of these can be included in the design of the bill itself and by the dynamic leadership that the composition of the Truth Commission may have. For example, I agree that there should be a healing process, but this is something that cannot be left. It's something that belongs to social psychology. What you can do, therefore, is that in the report, in the recommendation of the Truth Commission, it will include the creation of complementary institutions that will devote themselves to the healing process and maybe ease up the pain and solve the problem. It might recommend the creation of a trust committee for restitution or for damage to property or for what has been done not only with respect to property but the impairment of family ties of the children. But this is something that cannot be done, and I think that this should be left to the recommendation of the Truth Committee itself. The healing process should be emphasized, but at the same time, we should not neglect the enforceability of what is justice in the first place, with respect to, in particular, the violation of human rights. Thank you, Your Honor.
Your Honor.
Si Attorney Rocky muna.
Thank you, Your Honor. I am of the impression that the Truth Commission is to be convened to initially look into the Mamasapano incident. I am of the impression, and I truly believe, that this should be done so that we can consolidate and reconcile all the products of the investigating bodies that are doing their investigating work right now. Now, as to the purpose of that Truth Commission, if we are going to expand its purpose more than consolidation, more than reconciliation of the different investigating body reports, then that means we should expand also the bill. And we will now include, if the proponents of the bill would agree, the items mentioned by Father Bert, Attorney Marahom Salik, Professor Tayao. So this is the second part of the Truth Commission. Whether to create one, I think everybody agrees that we should create one. Whether it is called a board of inquiry, whether it's called a Truth Commission, there's a need to create one, if only to consolidate and reconcile all the reports of the other investigating bodies. As to its other purpose, to expand it to include the other matters mentioned by Father Bert and Mr. Attorney Marahom Salik and Professor Tayao, then it will be the judgment of the proponents of the bill whether to include this or not. Thank you.
Yes, I would like to state that, the bill is not written on stone. That's precisely why we have the hearing, so that we can get input so we can improve on the bill. We'd also like to state that when the bill was crafted, I think it was the day after the Mamasapano incident, so it was not clear who were the civilians, if there were any civilian casualties yet or MILF casualties. We were just going on what information we knew at that time. Attorney Mahram Salik, yes?
I just wish to pass upon the distrust now felt by Dr. Tayao, which is occasioned by the Mamasapano incident. Deputy Speaker of the House of Representatives, Pangalian Balindong, addressed the issue. He said, the Bangsamoro took ones for fees. First, we had an agreement. The Bangsamoro, through the MNLF, had an agreement with the government, the 1986 Tripoli Agreement. In the case of Abbas versus Comelec, the Supreme Court posited that as an executive agreement. But this was ignored, discarded by government, unilaterally implemented by government. That was made subject to future discussion in order to place into form and shape and substance other provisions. But the only close-ended provision there is the appointment of a Supreme Court, of a Muslim justice to the Supreme Court. It was done only once with the appointment of Justice Bidin. And that was not followed after his retirement, which means that the government can tinker with each agreement with the Bangsamoro. Second, the 1996 peace agreement, which has been the product of negotiation also between the government and the MNLF. And then third, we had the memorandum agreement on ancestral domain, which was unceremoniously discarded by government too. After initialing it, for all intents and purposes, that is a finished agreement. So there is this experience by the Muslim, and graphically, Representative Pangalian Balindong described it as a wound. So thrice or four times, the Bangsamoro took wounds for peace. Why can't you, for example, took wounds for peace also? I do not want to mention here again the representation of the chair of the peace panel of the MLF, Iqbal, where he cited in one Senate hearing the massacres that were done on civilians. See, which compared to the Mamasapano incident is, I do not want to describe it because I'm sensitive to the feelings of the relatives of the 44 sub. Thank you, Your Honor.
Professor Tayao?
Just very quickly, Mr. Chair. Attorney, actually, I agree with everything you said. And just to set the record, personally, I've written a number of papers also in support of peace. And that too, Moose knows this. In fact, there's a... Anyway, the point here is the reason why I said that there is some... there's a problem of public trust is precisely because this incident happened January 25. It's already a month after, and we're still searching for answers. And this is only the way I see how the public has been reacting to it. I mean, for those who have been doing some work in Mindanao, I don't claim to be an expert or what, but what I know is that in Mindanao, more or less, they understand exactly what happened, what's the importance of the BBL and Bangsamoro. But in the greater Philippine context, they really have to understand exactly the whole story. So the narrative will be, set straight. And that precisely this element of distrust can be put aside and we can move on. So that's the reason why I thought a truth commission is really essential so that kumbaga there is one report or there's truth really that the public can consider as the real story or narrative.
Professor Magalona.
It is difficult to equate the failures in the past with the present tragedy, because we are not operating on the PATA system. And just because there were massacres in the past, it does not mean that in any way the evaluation of the present tragedy could be minimized. We are dealing with the past. And my friend Nasser here it is difficult to revive what we had in the past, precisely because the negotiation that has just ended would close the thing of the past and revive what could be saved for the future reconciliation. Thank you, Your Honor.
The problem, Your Honor, is
with Attorney Nasser Mahoram Salig.
The Mamasapano incident, as articulated by the OPAP, as well as the military, do not lay the blame to the Malep. They mention about procedures which were not followed. That is the issue here. And I think we should take a leap of faith to understand the Bangsa Moro by referring to their past. You know, I was in a round table yesterday in Davao, and we talk about reconciliation. How can we effect reconciliation, for example, when there is this prejudicial issue? How, in reconciliation, there must be two parties at least. How can we reconcile each other? For example, with the majority, and the majority with the minority. When the majority do not know our history, do not know our past, it's not taught in universities, in public universities and colleges, as a curriculum course. It's a cognate in UP, in CEU, Central University, and then Mindanao State University. But on the whole, it's not taught. Muslim history, it's not taught in public schools. But there are books. So the problem is, as articulated by Father here, is communication. So how can you reconcile with us when you do not know us? That is the problem. There is a bill by Deputy Speaker Representative Pangalian Barindong to require the teaching of Muslim history in tertiary education. I would suggest that there should be a twin bill here in the Senate, and it should be acted immediately. Kasi that is the key. If we don't have any communication gap, we can understand each other very, very well. Thank you.
Thank you, Attorney Rocky Villanueva.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think this really, the statement of Attorney Mahoram Salig really applies to the Filipinos outside of Mindanao. Because we from Mindanao, we have very good relationship with our Muslim brothers. We went to school with them, we play games with them, they are our classmates, they are our acquaintances, and since we grew up with them, that issue has never arisen. But for people in the Visayas and in Luzon, the understanding of the Muslim history and Muslim culture is, I think, very important. For us in Mindanao, even if we don't go to school and study Muslim history, because we live with them, it has become part and parcel of our being Mindanaoans. Thank you.
If I may comment, Your Honor.
Okay, Attorney Mahoram Salig.
The problem is, people in Manila are fomenting disorder among us. If you may remember, the declaration of martial law was based on the chaotic conditions in Mindanao. And these chaotic conditions were promoted by people here in Manila to lengthen, you know, establish a dictatorship. That is the problem. And those who abuse the human rights of the Bangsa Moro were cuddled and protected. If you may remember, the founder of the Ilaga, which ravaged Muslim communities, Commander Toothpick, he was receiving Malacanang and fitted there. That is the problem. I really am one with the observation of the Dean here, that wala namang problema kami sa Mindanao noon eh, until there was this plan to create a dictatorship in this country. Kaya nga, mahirap rin ang healing process ngayon. I think you will agree with me. Kasi even among us, marami na ang nangyayari between the Muslims and the Lumach and the Christians in Mindanao. I think there is still also a need for healing in Mindanao. Kasi kung may mga incidente, for example, that will trigger, you know, deep-seated emotions against towards each other, yan, nangyayari na yan. In fact, there was this leader na nagsabi na he will send the Ilonggos from Iloilo to Mindanao and fight the Imaylop. You remember him? See, that's a leader. supposed to be enlightened leader. So kung nangyari yan sa mga enlightened leader here, eh, pwede mangyari sa amin na we're only rank and file. We're not highly educated people. So yun ang problema. Kaya we should not lose sight of the fact na kailangan rin sa amin ng healing, even in Mindanao. Although among us, lawyers, ay siyempre magkakampi kami. Oh, kasi we speak the same language. Eh. Oh, wala kaming problema sa isa't isa. We go to the same offices together, to the same nightclubs nung kabataan ko pa. Nung bata pa ako, ngayon hindi na.
Okay, thank you. Dean Magalona?
I feel that what my friend Nasser is saying would add to the necessity of creating a truth commission, because the truth commission would need a testimony that he has begun here. And I think that as a historical backdrop, as a historical background, we need a testimony like that in the truth commission. Thank you.
Thank you.
Should have the truth commission first.
Okay. 1 minute suspension. Yes. Before Senator Pimentel hearing resumed now. Before Senator Pimentel takes the mic, I'd like to point out a very intriguing observation of Dr. Tawao, that perhaps this could have been minimized had we adopted a federal system of government rather than a unitary system of government. Senator Pimentel.
That's correct. Federalism is now espoused by a very popular mayor from Mindanao City who was mixed blood, Christian and Muslim. Anyway, who is now always a member of my party. So, at any rate, Mr. Chairman, I have learned a lot in the short time that I have been with you. I want to share my thoughts as an author, as a co-author. No? When I co-authored this, actually, it was a fact. It's actually a fact-finding investigation, as stated in the title, on the very specific incident of Mamasapano, why it happened, and then of course, what's the purpose of knowing why, so that it should be prevented in the future, and then if there are some criminal negligence or acts, then punishment, because that's part of justice. I think the problem is when we gave the name Truth Commission, because I've learned from Attorney Maromsalik and the few words I heard from Dato Moose, when you say Truth Commission, you reach back. Yan ang problema. Pero that Truth Commission is qualified by the name of the place. Yan ang ginawa namin, Mamasapano Truth Commission. So, in effect, we're really focusing on just the Mamasapano incident, no? What really happened? Sino ba talaga yung ano? How to move forward because of this? But from our discussions this morning or today, it's obvious that we still have a void to be filled in the search for truth in what is happening in Mindanao. So maybe that could be the subject of another resolution or bill. Because that one, the Truth Commission, na wala ng qualifier na it's a Mamasapano Truth Commission, it's the Truth Commission on the Bangsamoro situation or in the Mindanao situation, that would really take time. So pwede sigurong you just gave me an idea. That could be a subject of another resolution or bill. Ganun na lang siguro po. Because ito talaga, when I signed this, dun lang sa January 24, 25 incident, and it should come out quickly. The report should come out quickly, because if we separate the sanction from the act, the deterrent effect of criminal laws weakens. Ano naman to, because I'm a lawyer and head of the chairman of the Justice Committee. So, yun ang aking point. So, that's why
It's really an act creating a fact-finding commission, and we just named it Mamasapano Truth Commission. So, but thank you for your inputs na when you use Truth Commission, loaded pala yung phrase na yan, yung name na yan, because it means really reach back to the past and then get the root cause. Oh. Pero hindi po, when I signed this, hindi po yun ang nasa isip ko. Ha? I mean, it's really just Mamasapano. Root cause of Mamasapano. Yun lang, why it happened. So I just want this clarification. But we can still pursue a truth commission in the sense that Attorney Marohom Salik and Dato Mus have mentioned it. No? That's all, Mr. Chairman.
May I ask a question, Your Honor?
To whom will it be directed?
Whoever wishes okay. to answer, Your Honor.
Sige, please.
In your explanation, do you intend that commission to get to a full dress hearing, just like what the Senate has been doing? A full dress hearing.
Ito? Yes, option nila, call nila.
And then you will reprise call the nila. Senate?
Call nila. We will not, of course, tie the hands of the members of the commission. It's really their call. It's their call. The point is, maybe you have to put some pressure, time pressure. Kasi they cannot, of course, take their time, di ba? To repeat what has been done, di ba? Pero it's really recall. Kasi hindi rin maganda na we come up with a law tying up the hands of very restrictive na binigyan natin ng blinders yung commissioners. Parang sasabihin, linuluto na natin yung resulta. So call po nila. Ayan, when I sign this, yun ang aking intention, call nila.
Ako naman, I'm also intrigued by your concept of clarificatory and what's that term when you reconciling the different reports of the other bodies. That's a very intriguing, and I'd take a hard look at that also.
Mr. Chair, dun sa press con natin when we filed this, tinanong na yun at sinabi na natin part call na nila yun, but of course common sense yun eh. Marami nang nangyari, they could gather. And then that can really fall under Section 3G. They can call upon the departments in instrumentalities to produce the documents. So in the Senate, TSN, House, TSN, Board of Inquiry report.
Sandali lang po. I think Dato Mus wants to say something.
With that clarification, Your Honor, we truly support the creation of the Truth Commission, or specifically for Mamasapano. However, I would like to know if the output or the investigation of the Truth Commission would be a condition for the resumption of the BBL, or it's a separate thing?
Also answered, Mr. Chairman, in our press conference, hindi. Actually, ang position ko nga, even the investigation of the Senate Public Order Committee should not be a condition precedent for the resumption of BBL. Wala, hindi. So all the more, ito rin, hindi.
Yes, because right now we have some NGOs from Mindanao here with us, and they came to see me kanina, and they were really asking what's the fate of the BBL now. Number one, I don't think the BBL should be hostage to the Mamasapano incident. And Senator Pimentel, yes.
Sabihin na lang natin sa kanila yung katotohanan na ako, I'm a new member of the Senate, at itong sinasabi sa akin, in the Senate, the chairman is the committee. So, alam niya, ibig kong sabihin, we have to lobby to the chairman to resume. Kung saan na-assign yung bill na BBL, yung chairman ng committee na yun, we lobby with the chairman to resume the hearings. The chairman is the committee, yun ang sabi sa akin. Which I'm finding out is true.
Okay, Attorney Mus, you want to say something?
Your Honor, it's good that you made mention of that, because as I told Father Albert, this is also a way of healing the past, because part of those injustices that we see or we studied in the past are related to the chairman that you are referring to. So it's really a way of healing this nation of the mistakes of the past be correct in our time. Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you. It's
pwede po bang magtanong? Pwede bang lifespan ng that Mamasapano thing, mga 2 months, something like that?
I mean, this commission, you mean this commission?
Yes, it created.
Senator Pimentel has a comment.
But realistic din, kasi mag-issue siya ng mga subpoena, alam na natin na, realistic din naman, wag naman 2 months. Pero wala dito, no? So I think we improve it, no? By putting a lifespan or ano. Pero we look for a realistic ano, period of time.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Anyone else would like to add to the discussion before we terminate these proceedings? So again, I'd like to thank everyone for their inputs. It's a very stimulating morning. Again, thank you very much. This hearing is hereby adjourned.